Lord, we thank you for who you are. You are so awesome, Lord. You are so mighty. We love you, Lord, so much, for you're just worthy to be praised, Lord. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your blessings that you've given us day by day, Lord. And we're just thankful for this amazing time, this weekend, Lord, where we got to just meditate on what it means, Lord, to have a relationship with our either husbands or wives, or with dealing with dating, Lord, or being single and pure, Lord. And we just thank you for what you spoke to us and what you would continue to speak to us, Lord. We have faith that you love us, Lord, and that you care about what we live for, Lord. And we just ask you to reveal that for us today. We're here to worship you, Lord, this morning, give you the glory, and just eager to spend some wonderful time with you, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's worship, everyone. He's awakening the hope in me by calling forth my destiny. He's breathing life into my soul. I thirst for him and him alone. He has come like a rain showers on. So my heart, tongue confess, Jesus Christ, hope in man.
Let's declare that the hope in Jesus Christ, my hope is in you.
My hope is in you, God. I am steadfast, I will not.
Oh,
hope to the hopeless, giving his heart to the broken, sharing his home with the orphan. He is the joy, he is my joy, he is the hope of the nations. Father's heart we're embracing, he is the song we're declaring. He is the joy, he is my joy, he's bringing hope to the hopeless, giving his heart to the broken, sharing his home with the orphan. He is the joy, he is my joy, he is the hope of the nations. The Father's heart we're embracing, he is the song we're declaring. He is the joy, he is my joy. Shaken, all my hope is in you. The ground beneath my feet gives way, and I hear the sound of crashing waves. All my world is washing out to sea. Hidden safe in the God who never moves, holding fast to the promise of the truth that you're holding tighter still to me. Sing it together, the rock. The rock won't move, and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock of our salvation. Hope is in the promise of the blood, my support within the raging flood. Even in the tempest I can see. Hidden safe in the God who never moves, holding fast to the promise of the truth that you're holding tighter still to me. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock of our salvation. Whoa. Won't move, well, the rock won't move. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. The rock won't move, no, the rock won't move. On Christ the solid rock I stand, on other ground and sinking sand. The rock won't move, no, the rock won't move. darkness seems to hide his face and rest on his unchanging grace. The rock won't move, oh, the rock won't move. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock won't move and his word is strong. The rock won't move and his love can't be undone. The rock of our salvation. My heart to break me apart. I need you. Open my eyes to see that you're shaping my life. Sing together, all I am. All I am, I surrender. Me faith to trust what you say, that you're good, your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I need you. Heart to break me apart, I need you to pierce through the dark, cleanse every part of me. All I am, I surrender. Give me what you say, that you're good, your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life. I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you
I may be weak.
I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. I may be weak, your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good, your love is great. I give you my life.
Sing it, I may be weak.
I may be weak. Your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail. My God, you never will. I may be weak. Your spirit's strong in me. My flesh may fail, my God, you may.
your spirit strong in me, my flesh may fail. My God, you never will.
Lord, we thank you, for you are the rock of our salvation. For when we fall, you strengthen us, Lord. You lift us up. You are the rock of our salvation. We thank you for who you are, Lord, for trusting you, leaning on you when we're weak, when we are weary, Lord. We love you, Lord, and we are so eager to hear what you have in store for us. We pray in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Well, good morning. If those of you were not with us this weekend, or who was with us this weekend for the Fall Flint Conference? I was hoping for a scream. Yeah, we only got Natty back here. Okay, everyone else is still waking up. We're still trying to figure out and digest everything we learned from this weekend. But we had Melody and CD with us this weekend. We talked on a lot of different topics. It was an exciting weekend. Yesterday night was exceptional, with the Q&A and everything else that we learned throughout the weekend. If you all do not know about Melody and CD, they will tell you more about themselves, but they were on CNN, Fox News, Weird News we heard. I mean, they were everywhere, right? So their story kind of went viral, and it is a great story to bring to the glory of God. And we're excited that they are here today to kind of talk more on that. So with great applause, let's introduce Melody and CD.
Good morning. It's been a good weekend. And we're glad that the Lord has allowed us to come back. We came here about 3 years ago, right? I think it was 3 years ago. And it was good because I feel like we're family here. And we are from Chicago. We're not going to go through our whole story, but just to kind of give you guys a little recap of it. You know, I didn't grow up in church. I got saved when I was 12 years old. And, you know, my family didn't serve the Lord, so I was serving the Lord by myself for a long time and praying for my family for a long time. At 16 is when I heard a very clear message about purity, and I didn't know that God created sex. I thought the devil created it, and so I was like, oh wait, this is God's idea, and he created it in the context of a marriage relationship. And at the age of 16, that's when I made a decision, I'm going to wait until marriage. And fast forward, I went to a Bible college, and now I'm at this Bible college, and there's all these men of God, and I'm just like, Lord, who is he, Lord? And I had to really learn to trust the Lord. Got into a dating relationship that, you know, was good but not God's best, and God called me out of that relationship. And when I was being obedient to him, he told me, I want you to be single for 7 years. I was like, Lord, let's pray again. I think the devil's talking. But when I kept saying, God, what are you saying? He said, I want 7 years. And I gave him 7 years by his grace, by his strength. And on the sixth year of my seven-year commitment, I went on a mission trip to Africa. And that's when I met this man of God right here. And it was cool because the year that I made my seven-year vow was the year that he got saved. And so he kind of tells a story that he says, the Lord was like, hold on, girl, I got to work on him. But we got worked on each other, right? And, you know, God brought us together, and we saved our first kiss for our wedding day. We haven't stopped kissing since. And the Lord has used us greatly, and now we're going on our eighth year of marriage. And it's, you know, I give God all the glory for what he's doing in us and through us. And our hope today, as we were praying, like, what's the word? You know, my husband felt a word of just about reconciliation. And so, you know, come with an open heart. I think sometimes when we grow up in church or we know the word, we just get very familiar. And don't let familiarity rob you, you know. Come with an expectancy of, like, Lord, what do you want to say to me about my relationship and about the relationships with you and me? So may we hear from the Lord today. I present to you my husband.
Let's pray. Father God, we stand before you with awe and trembling because you are so gracious to us, and you invite us into your presence. You have given us your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us sins while we were yet still sinners. And I was a great sinner, Lord God, in the world doing crazy things, drinking and smoking and sleeping around and being very selfish. But you saw through all of that and said, I love this man. I love this woman. I love these people. And you gave us your son. And he died on the cross for our sins. And his blood washes over us. And we are so forever grateful. And you raised from the dead on the third day by the power of the Holy Spirit and has birthed us with that same Spirit. And now I'm alive in you. And you've given us a testimony. And we share it. We share it boldly and we share it lovingly and we share it hoping, Father God, that it would spark hope and desire for what you have for us. And you've given us a word today. And I pray that through my feeble lips and weak frame, that your Spirit would be strong and that you would do great things. As my wife said, Father, I pray that our hearts would be open, even the one speaking presently, that you would do new and deep things in our hearts. And Father, we trust that this rich seed will continue to go forth and do wonderful things for other people who are outside of these walls, that as this church grows, that you would bless many people in the city of Houston. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So we've had a wonderful, wonderful time sharing about our testimony. And somebody said to us that one of the things that has been so refreshing about you guys is that you're just so real. You're just so honest. Like, I don't really hide my issues or my shame or anything, you know? And so my wife and I have been married for going on 8 years this coming November. And this is very exciting for us. And we have been invited to participate in this ministry called Family Life, where we get to learn and talk more about marriage ministry. And it's so crazy because we got issues, you know, and it's not like we're a perfect marriage couple. In fact, I can recall times where Melody and I have had tiffs. And when we've had those tiffs, I've learned, God has shown me how to still express my love and my concern and my affection towards my wife, even when she makes me upset, when she drives me nuts. How many of you are married and your spouse drives you nuts sometimes? Arm shot up real high. And the wives are like, be quiet, you know? And it's so true. I can recall times when my wife and I, we've had various discussions with little things like how we apologize to each other. Have you ever felt like your wife or your husband just doesn't get you? And when you're upset about something, they seem to not be upset either. And you're like, you should be upset about this. I'm upset. And they're like, what? What is it? What's wrong? And I remember my wife and I don't remember the exact specific reason why we got into one of these tiffs, but It got pretty heated in our hearts. I mean, the flames were just going in the eyes, and it's almost like, I can't believe you right now, you know? And I think, like many other men, we have a tendency to, actually, this is pretty interesting. I learned this from an old pastor that in tough situations, some men are inclined to avoid, blame, and shut down. And it's just something that it's in our part of our sin nature. And when we can't fix something, you know, us men, we like to fix things. And when we feel like we can't fix her, we can't get her to see our way, we have a temptation to avoid and then to blame and then to shut down. And so I was going through this totally in my mind. I wanted to say some things to her. I wanted to jab back. I wanted to cause for her to feel what I'm feeling, but I knew that I really shouldn't do that because I could really hurt her. And so in my brain, I just started to avoid the situation. And then I could feel myself wanting to blame and wanting to say that she's not getting it and it's her fault. And I couldn't say any of those things because in my mind, I was like, I can't say that. I can't do that. And I began to start to feel like I was shutting down. And so the next things that we tend to do is we just leave, right? We just leave. And just walk out the house. And I was like, no, I can't do that. I can't just walk out the house. That would be so, oh man, just like she wouldn't know how what I was feeling, what I was thinking. Am I coming back? Like, is he leaving? Like, what is going on? And so I was like, I can't do that. In my brain, all these bad things are happening. But I'm choosing to recall the things that I've learned. And I walked up to my wife, and I said to her, I said, honey, we're gonna have to continue this conversation a little later. I'm really frustrated, but I love you. But I'm really frustrated. So I need some space. I'm gonna leave, but I'll be back. Oh, it took everything inside of me to just be able to say those words. Because at the time, I was not happy with her. My feelings and my affections were not for her in the moment. But how many of you know that love is not just about feelings and affections, right? Love has to be founded so much more than just feelings and affections, because those things sway. I mean, it's like, I don't know, we do this with food. You say, oh, what do I want to eat today? And you're like, you see like Chick-fil-A, and you're like, oh, I'm tired of Chick-fil-A. I've had Chick-fil-A like so often, right? And then next week you're like, you know, I really want some Chick-fil-A. And it just shifts just like that. And our feelings, you know, that's just for food, but how much more for like your wife and your husband and your love? And so I had to stand on our rock who loves us, whose love is not teeter-tottering, right? And I had to act like God, because not that I am God, but he's given us his spirit, he's given us his nature. And I had to express a love that I didn't feel, but I knew was true. And I communicated truth. I wasn't lying. I wasn't like, I love you. You know, I had to tell her, and I said, I'll be back. And I told her exactly what I was going to do. I'm going to go and pray. I may call Pastor Armand, that was our pastor at the time, and then I'll be back and we'll continue conversation. And so I step outside and I'm venting to the Lord. I said, I can't believe this, Lord. She's like this and she is like that, and she's frustrated. She doesn't understand me. And I'm like, I'm confessing a lot of things. I'd say things to God that I would never want her to hear, because I'm still her husband. I'm still supposed to cover her and to guard her. But in my private time with the Lord, I can go and I'm like, why did you bring us together? We're so different. How is this gonna work, this marriage relationship? And I'm going through all these things and I'm just like, oh my gosh. And when I'm tired, like, I mean, you ever vent so much, you get tired, you're like breathing like you just ran a marathon, you're like, I mean, you got it all out. I mean, you're like, okay. And it's almost like I can feel God being like, are you done? You ever have that? Like, are you through? Can I talk now? You know? And so I'm walking around my neighborhood and people probably think I'm crazy because I'm just talking to God, and they're like, he's crazy, you know? And I'm like, ah. Oh. And when you get to that place, I love God that he just lets us finish, that he lets us get done. I'm empty. He let me vent it all out. And then he just whispers something so gentle and sweet. And he's like, are you done? I'm like, yeah, I'm done. What do you have to say? I don't really want to hear, but I know you're going to say something. And he's just like, call Pastor Armand. Let him know how you're feeling. And I'm like, I got to call another guy. He's going to know all my junk. This is hard. He's like, do you want to be accountable? Do you want some help? Man sharpens man as iron sharpens iron, right? So call Pastor Armand. So I call Pastor Armand. He says, what's going on, bro? And I'm like, man, my wife, this and that, the other. And, you know, you start to vent again, and all of a sudden the energy and the passion starts coming back out. And then I calm down again, and he says, well, bro, God is refining you. He's taking you deeper. He's showing you how to love like he loves. Do you love your wife? I'm like, yeah, I love my wife. So go back to her. Speak to her with gentleness. Speak to her with calm. Tell her exactly how you feel. And trust that God is doing a work in her too. Be patient. Suffer long. All these words, they sound familiar, right? Like the fruit of the Spirit. And God is trying to develop more fruit in me. And so I'm like, okay. We talked about a number of things. And I pray again, and the Lord kind of gives me strategy of how to approach my wife. And I think I kind of shocked her, because her last interaction with me was like, I'm frustrated. I love you, but I'm frustrated, and I'm going to leave. And now I come back, and I'm like, I'm the man. I need to initiate, right? So I apologize first. So humbling. Especially when you feel like she's the main reason, and I just added like 20% of this argument. I go, babe, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have spoken to you like that. And I just want to let you know that I love you, and I will always be with you. And let's discuss this first. And I would touch her, and I would just, you know, love on her, and I'll sit close to her, and I'll grab her, and I'll say, this is what I'm feeling. This is what I'm thinking. What about you? And man, she just becomes like butter in my hands. You know, it's just like, because I just wanted you to know that I felt like this and I felt like that. And everything inside of me is like, she's crying. Oh, but I'm like, okay, okay. And then finally we were able to reconcile. And that's hard. But the more you do it, the easier it becomes. And not just the easier it becomes to communicate, but the easier it becomes to overcome those differences, the easier it becomes to, you know, the ease of handling differences. When you're handling those differences in the beginning, it's like sparks are flying, like, you know, two blades are going with each other, and you're watching one of those Japanese films, and it's like, right? But then after a while, it's like, I don't need to remove myself as often. It doesn't take as long for God to speak. It doesn't take as long for my heart to conform. It doesn't take as long for her to understand what we're talking about. It doesn't take as long for us to reconcile. Because just like any other thing in life, it takes practice. We're not perfect at the ministry of reconciliation. We're not perfect at learning our spouses and understanding their point of view. And something our pastor told us when we were getting married, I was 30 years old when we would eventually marry, and she was 28. And she said, or the pastor said, he said, you know, you guys are getting married a little later in life. So you're going to have the temptation to be a little more settled in your ways. But marriage is becoming one. It's a process, right? When Adam beheld his wife, he says, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, right? And then he says, the two shall become one. And it's so great in scripture. We see so many things where God talks about how something is, and yet it's still being, and then yet it will be. It's like everything is a process for God, because he lives outside of time. And for him, the decision's made. He's done it. It's done. But we have to go through that process of it becoming. And that's part of the issue in relationships, that especially, like I said, when you're a bit older, you've been single for so long, you've done certain things certain ways, you folded your clothes certain ways. That's an inside joke for my wife and I, because when we were engaged, we went to the laundromat to do some laundry. And she started folding my clothes a certain way. And I've been single for so long, I got a system. You know, everybody thinks that I've been in the military for so long because I'm so kind of clean and cut and everything. And I have a system. I'm like, no, babe, not like that, like this. And I start showing her, like, this is how I'd like for you to do it. And she goes, you know, wait, I fold your clothes. What are you doing? What just happened? But it's just something simple, things like that. And we were able to talk about that too. I was like, babe, it's okay. You know, you can fold it whichever way you want. But in time, she's conformed, and I've conformed to things that she's desired, and she's conformed to things that I've desired. And it's just this ongoing process of learning each other and yielding. And here's the kicker. The more you go in God, the more pliable he makes you. The more you go in God, the more pliable he makes you. And so as much as we want to change each other, it's only God who can change us. And when you start hitting that roadblock where I want you to understand what I'm talking about, I want you to get my point of view, I want you to change,
And we get angry, get frustrated because they're not changing. And then we start to say things like, well, they must not love me. Because if they loved me, then they would do it this way to serve me. Because we all know theologically that we're supposed to serve one another. But what we really mean is you need to serve me. And then when you go to God and he goes, well, actually, if you want to be great, you should serve her. And I'm like, I do want to be great. Then be the servant. And that's where you go deeper. And you know who becomes pliable? You. You know who changes? You. And then you pray and you trust that God will do the same thing in that other person. But your joy remains. And because when God makes you pliable, he doesn't just make you do those things. He like immerses you with his love. He immerses you with his water and his spirit. And you just become soft. And the production of that is greater joy in his presence, greater peace in his presence. And that becomes the source of your happiness and whatnot. And it's almost like, well, if they change or not, I'm still having this awesome experience with God. And you can be so much more pliable. And what happens is the other person begins to see that and go, what is that in you? What is that in you? And you're like, I'm just really enjoying God right now in this season. And it should prod and make them go, man, I need that too. And then they start going into God. And you're not like, you need to go see God. They just see your fruit. You see that? And so these are some things that I learned along the way. And I think that in our culture, we're just so used to getting our way right away, like Burger King. That's not how the kingdom of God works. A couple days ago, I was praying for you guys, and I said, Lord, what is your word for this church? And what is the word that you want them to carry outside of these four walls? What is the word that you want to put inside of them? And then what is the word you want to reproduce in them? Not just with their spouses, but with other people in the world. And he gave me the word reconciliation. Reconciliation. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, if you guys want to take your time to go there, verses 3, 4, and 5. It says, let the husband render to his wife the affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. And this word affection can be also translated, the ESV says conjugal rights. It almost kind of sounds like a demand. I didn't like that version, but another version says intimate affection, intimacy. Let the husband give to his wife the intimate affection due her, and likewise also the wife to her husband. The wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another except with consent for a time, that you may give yourselves to fasting and prayer, and come together again so that Satan does not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Now, the many times I've read that in the past, I saw the lack of self-control directly related to my inability to practice self-control sexually. And that, I think, is a main point here. But it's also just a natural disposition of practicing self-control. It could be self-control when you're angry, self-control when you're frustrated and don't want to communicate, self-control when you want to blow up, self-control when you want to shut down. All these things demand self-control because Satan roams around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And in this particular case of weakness, when there is a time with consent, but how many of you know that sometimes it's not with consent? when we are not being intimate with each other, that he got that Paul says, God says through Paul, come back together again. This is the reconciliation. And it's so that Satan doesn't tempt you. I'm going to take a little turn and talk about other things that we need to practice self-control of, especially when we have tiffs, as I shared, with regard to our spouses. The issue of offense. Offense is one of those things that without consent, we remove ourselves, right? Don't raise any hands, but how many times have you been tempted to not want to be intimate with your spouse because they got on your last nerve about something? And you're like, oh, heck no, I'm not going to be intimate. You want to sleep on the couch, right? And I'm not just saying that you go and be intimate with that person. You force yourself to be intimate with that person. But you have to go through that process of reconciling. Because the enemy is looking at that as an opportunity to divide you even further apart. And if you allow that separation, the principle here is Satan is going to take advantage of it. And then you know what happens? Because we are sexual beings, we start to think and look elsewhere. You've heard the term, the grass always seems greener on the other side. And we start to entertain these thoughts in our minds. Well, what if this? And what if that? Beware of the what ifs. Those what ifs are so, so dangerous. So, when you're offended with one another, what should we do? In Luke chapter 17, Jesus talks to his disciples with regard to offense. And he says to them that it's impossible that you would go through this world and not be offended. And then he says, now, of course, when you are offended, he says that we must forgive. He says in verse 3, take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. Now, I know that sounds like sharp, like rebuke him, right? But you're dealing with your spouse. So you see how I left? I gathered myself. I came back and I said, here's what I was feeling. Here's what I was talking about. And this is how you made me feel. And then she just began to be like butter and cry and weep in my hands. You know why? Because she could see both sides now. Because I presented it in a way that was more palatable for her to receive. And it was like a gentle, soft rebuke. You get that? And when it was a gentle, soft rebuke, and likewise when she does that for me, you go, oh, man, I'm so sorry. And he says that he's going, this is a tactic of showing how extreme something should be because how important the message is. And he says, and if he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. And the apostles reply and be like, increase our faith. They're hearing this principle about forgiveness, and they're like, that's crazy. That's a lot. I don't know if I can do that. Seven times? And they just keep going, I'm so sorry, I forgot. You're like, but you've done it seven times. Forgive them. Talk it out. Have that conversation. Go through the process. And then he says, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and planted into the sea, and it would obey you. Sometimes our offenses can become so deep in our heart, it becomes rooted. And when it gets rooted, it's not a healthy tree. It's a tree of bitterness. And that bitterness now becomes something spiritual. And I personally believe that this is a spiritual seed that the enemy plants because there's room in your heart due to unforgiveness. And now you have to go to God and pray and do spiritual warfare and say, I command this bitter root. I command this mulberry tree, this big obstacle in my heart to be uprooted and thrown into the sea. And now there's this space for you to let the Lord fill. And then you can come to the to your spouse and seek reconciliation. Another obstacle, can be the fear of intimacy. So we have the obstacle of offense and the fear of intimacy. My wife shared with me something that I thought was very profound, and I'd like to share it with you. She says, intimacy is both vulnerable, and that vulnerability positions the other person with power. And this then now has the potential to build great trust. And that's where a lot of people struggle, because we don't want to give anybody that kind of power. To give somebody that kind of a power puts yourself at risk. Vulnerability is risk. But you cannot be intimate without vulnerability. And so it says here, when you're vulnerable, it's scary, because you now have given the person the ability to use something against you. When you share and say, I really struggle with this, or I really struggle with that, that person now has the ability to turn that against you and make you feel even worse. But it says it's like handing them a weapon and power in the relationship. But when your spouse had that power and doesn't use it, it builds trust. You say, wow, you've given me this thing so deep about yourself. And instead of seeing it as a weapon, they see it as something that they should care for and cover and protect and love. And so we were teaching with the singles, and we were talking a lot about what happens in various seasons when you're being friends and when you're dating and when you're engaged. And we think that it's very, very important for people to build those levels of trust with each other so that they can build that intimacy. And you'll begin to see. So what happens if they misuse it? And then it goes back to the issue of offense. Then you've got to go to God, have him help you to forgive them, maybe make some wiser choices, but continue to walk in freedom. Last thought. Some have reserved and held hostage their intimacy and vulnerability with God because of offenses. He didn't do this. He didn't do that. He didn't come in this way. And it's the same principle. That offense becomes an obstruction between our intimacy with God, who's the only one who can heal us and can restore us. And this takes faith, because we have to believe that God's ways are higher than our ways, and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts, and that he desires good for us, and that he is making all things for good to those who love him and are called according to his purposes, and that even when we don't get what he's doing, that we still trust him. It was Job who said, yea, though he slay me, yet I will trust him. So I just want to encourage you and invite you to pray for a moment and have the Holy Spirit search your heart and say, God, have I been reserving and holding back affection from my spouse because of offense? Help me to go back and reconcile and communicate the way that this was expressed. And have I been holding back and reserving intimacy and vulnerability with you because I didn't understand what you were doing, or you didn't do things the way I wanted? Help me to release that to you and trust that you will reform me
and heal me and transform me. And then so much joy, so much peace, so much calm comes into intimate relationships. First between him and your Lord, and second between you and your spouse or your spouse-to-be. Amen? Very simple word. If I could have somebody come up and play a little bit, and I'm just going to lead you in a short little prayer, and I'm trusting that this deposit of life and hope from God's word will germinate and do much more work outside of this moment, because again, it's a process. Amen? Let's pray. Hallelujah. Father God, to be honest, this could be somewhat of a sore topic. Because when there's a wound and the doctor has to approach that wound, our natural recourse is to cover it, to not let anybody get near it. But we trust that you are the great physician, and you know exactly how to go into those places of pain and hurt and bring healing. And I pray that, Father, this word of reconciliation, that it's a process, that it takes time, that it takes practice, that we may stumble over it, and we may stumble over it, and we may offend, and we may be offended. As we look in your word, we can yet still trust that as you deal with us and soften our hearts, that you can bring great healing, and with that healing, great joy and great peace and great wisdom. And we can come back to those who've been offended or have we've caused offense to, and we can reconcile. In another place, you said that you've given us the ministry of reconciliation. You've done it first with us, and you teach us to do it with those closest to us. And then the world would see the example of Christ in us, especially with our spouses and our church members and family, and they will be attracted to the love and the joy and this free-flowing forgiveness that goes both ways, and they would better understand how God truly does forgive us. So I pray, God, that as you search our hearts, that couples would go and have conversations later on this week, that singles would seek your face and prepare their hearts for the same, and that if some of us here ourselves are frustrated with you, as you come gently to the table of reconciliation, that you would invite them to meet you there, and they can hash out their differences with you. What a good God who doesn't demand but comes to us gently and loving, sacrificial. So, Father, we thank you for your word. We pray it produces your great fruit for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.